bit with sickness and all that, and we've had it through our home, but you know what? God gets ultimate victory.
Yeah.
We're still standing, right?
Yeah.
We're still going. And I know at times it feels like, oh, man, it's a rough day, but you know what? One of my colleagues always said, Tim, every day above ground is a good day. So, so we got to praise the Lord this morning, and we got to thank the Lord. One thing that I always try to look at is try to look at how good God is to you.
Yes.
In the course of your life, in the course of your day, every hour.
Amen.
Because he has blessed us so much. And sometimes we dwell on what we don't have instead of realizing what we do have.
That's right.
It's always amazing to me when Creator choose to talk to you, choose to listen to you. That is absolutely so awesome.
Yes.
I was thinking about a friend of mine who every year around harvest time, they'd have a chili dump, and they'd have a tractor rides and a bonfire. And one night I had the opportunity to speak there, and it was just such a clear night. I mean, it was dark sky, and you could see the stars, and you just look up, and some days and some nights you feel God is so close to you.
Yeah.
You just absolutely feel he's right there. But you can't get any closer than living inside of you.
That's right.
You know? And to imagine that the God that started all this lives inside of you and is guiding you and loves you. I mean, that is so powerful. To imagine what God, you have that power, that work within you. And to just dwell on God, I just really feel, as I've talked to my sister about once a month or so, and we get on that subject, it says, this is the time to start praising God. This is the time to be thankful for what God has done. Because our problems, you know, we look at our problems, and I know Tammy Faye Baker, you know, always sang that song, you know, God is bigger. And he is, you know, he's bigger than anything. And sometimes we think our problems are bigger than God can handle.
Yeah.
And it's just not the case. Can you imagine that? I mean, sometimes the kids, our grandkids will come to you and they ask you to help them with this. And to them, it's a really major thing. It really is. They're trying to lift something, and it's a major thing. And they're straining, and I can't do this, I can't do this. But when they ask for help, when they ask somebody stronger, you know, a greater than Elijah is here. A greater, just think you can come and you can help them. And he said, you know what we're going to do? I'm not going to just lift it for you. I'm going to come alongside you.
Yes.
And I'm going to lift it with you.
Yes.
Because the Bible talks about the disciples. God was working with them.
Yeah.
That is absolutely so powerful. He's working with them. And the thing that I love about God is that, you know what? He takes us from here to get us over here, but he's going with us the whole way.
That's right.
When Jesus said, come follow me, if you're following somebody, they're walking in front of you. I love that.
Yeah.
You know, we had a conference. I worked for DMAC. We had a conference, and sometimes we talk about dealing with students and dealing with things. And one thing that we always want to know, we're not going to ask the students to do anything we won't do first.
Yes.
That'd be kind of unfair. I teach truck driving. Here's the keys, and you figure out how to drive the truck your own. That would be unfair to them. See, and that's what Jesus did. He come down. He was just like us. One of his favorite words, Son of Man. Isn't that neat? Jesus said, Son of Man. The Son of God is Son of Man. So he can identify. He understands how it feels to be rejected.
Yep. That's
right.
He understands how people lie on him. He understands that some didn't believe in him.
Yep.
He understands that. He understands when they denied him. Peter, that is such a touching story. When Peter denied him, because Peter, you know, some people have mouths that get him into trouble a lot, you know, and Peter was
Amen.
One. Amen? Peter was kind of, you know, the rest of these guys, they'll deny him, but not old Pete. No, old Pete. No, I would definitely not old Pete. I'll stand with the Lord. Said, for the conqueror, he's going to deny me three times. Isn't that something? Deny him. And you remember all the garden and everything, and then he's kind of following afar off, and he's warming himself. Hey, wait, you sound like one of them. What are you talking about? You know, and and you said, oh, oh, wait a minute, it's your language. You was there in the garden. Well, I didn't know. I don't even know him. And that's bad.
Yeah.
When you done spent 3.5 years with him,
yeah,
that's just not an outright lie. You, I don't even know who you're talking about. That's bad.
Yeah.
But you ever notice something? After all the episode, and Peter went out and cried, and wonder what he cried about. The Bible said he wept bitterly. So you know it was a serious cry out there. What have I done? But you know what? I love God so much. When Jesus and Peter had a chance to sit down and talk, you know what? Jesus never brought that up to him. Yet there's no scripture that says he brought it up. You know, he is, hey, you know, Peter, I really don't appreciate what you did. Some people would. Some people bring it up. But not God. He didn't. He just said, he says, do you love me?
Yeah.
That's what he talked about. Do you love me? Because you understand, how much sorrowful can Peter get? You know, I often say sorry doesn't fix everything. You know, we kids pick on each other and say, tell your brother sorry. Well, they're not sorry. They just, because you told them to say they're sorry. If you're really sorry, then your behavior's going to change, so you don't want to do that again.
Right.
That's the big difference.
Yeah.
You know, don't just fix everything, those words. It's your actions that follow up your words.
Amen.
And that makes a difference. If we, I've said this oftentimes when I speak, but it's true. Jesus died for us, so we want to live for him.
Amen.
Okay? We can't, we wasn't the sacrifice. He was a sacrifice for us. He gave his life for us. And for the rest of our life, what we ought to do is say, God, I want to serve you. I want to be grateful for what you've done for me. That's the difference.
Yeah.
That's what causes people's lives to change. You know, I mean, if somebody's got a sentence of 100 years, they're facing 100 years in jail, and the judge says, you know what? I'm going to let you off. Now, I'll tell you what did I, we've got to be rejoicing then. I met a guy that was facing 40-some years. 40-some years. And he ended up getting 18 months. Now, how do you do that? And you know, he brought that up a lot. He says, I was facing all this. How does that happen? You get 18 months or 2 years, 3 years on a 40-year sentence. And he realized one thing. That's what he realized.
That's
right. I will share this, and I'm going to share a scripture. There's a guy I worked with when I worked for Walmart, and he had a heart transplant. And the cost of that heart transplant was $1 million. And he got his transplant, and he came, and he ended up working as a greeter down in Mount Pleasant. And I came in the store, and I saw him one day, and I was just so happy to see him, and how you feeling, and how things going. And I never forget this. I never forget this. He would not even look up to heaven. He was so humbled that God had gave him more life. He did not even look up. I remember he just looked down like this, you talk about a testimony.
Mm-hmm.
Just for him to point up, I knew who he was talking about. It wasn't the man upstairs. I kind of always hated that.
Yeah.
You know, it might be my cousin that's upstairs. I don't know. The man upstairs. We know who we're talking about. It's the God up in heaven. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
That's the difference right there.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I'm going to share a scripture, Isaiah 65. And chapter 65, 16. So it shall be that he who invokes a blessing himself in the land shall do so by saying, may the God of truth and fidelity, the amen, bless me. And he who takes an oath in the land and swear by the God of truth and faithfulness of his promises, the amen, because the former troubles are forgotten. It's Isaiah 65, 16. Because the former troubles are forgotten, because they are hidden from my eyes. For behold, and it's verse 17, I create new heavens and new earth, and the former things should not be remembered or come into mind. I'm telling you what, that is powerful. That is absolutely powerful. And I go down to verse 24 of Isaiah 65, and it should be that before they call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear. Boy, is that powerful? Before they even called. Have you had prayers like that, that the answer was on the way before you even got it out?
Yeah.
And that's the way God does. He's always running ahead of us.
That's right.
He's always got plans for us.
That's right.
You know, and that's what I love about God. He's always planning ahead. He's always got a plan for
yes.
your life.
Yes.
I've always believed that from the Bible talks about before he was formed in your mom's belly, God knew you. And he understands that, you know what? Okay, we're going to grow together. I just see that house important to lock arms and say, hey, what, God, I don't understand what's going on in life, but I'm going to trust you.
Yes.
These hard times, I don't get that. I don't understand. You know, we've had different losses and stuff in the congregation family and different things. We had an uncle pass away actually on Valentine's Day. And it's hard with his family and all that. But you know what? We just have to believe that God's still working for the good.
Amen.
Because sometimes those losses cause you to realize that he was a younger guy. And it caused you to realize that, you know what? Where am I in my life? Because we are not promised tomorrow. And that's why it's good to live today and celebrate God and do everything he asks you to do today.
Amen.
When he asks you to pray for somebody.
Yes.
You know, I don't take it a light thing when somebody comes to you and says, hey, brother, would you pray with me? Would you agree with me? That is powerful.
Yes.
You know, I'm not going to blow by, you know, I got to watch the Looney Tunes. I'll pray for you later. No, let's go right down here, and we're going to pray right together. I like when I grew up in church, you know, we had the altar calls. If they last to 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that's the way they do. I mean, they would pray. You know, we had people that would pray in the church, and you go to them ladies. Boy, you talk about them ladies. They could grab hold of God, and they would stay with God until you broke through. And that's the big difference. So we're going to go ahead and open up this testimony service and testify today of what God has done for you. So who'd like to go? Yes.
So, you know, a couple things. Still need prayer for a new job.
Yes.
Don't know if I'll have one tomorrow when I go back to work. But it was interesting because I'm learning to thank the Lord for the trials.
Yes.
And it just was a whole new level of crazy this week at work. But Thursday, my boss, so there's 5 of us on our team. And my boss calls me crying. And the Lord just opened up the door. You know, I haven't had the best always relationship with my boss. My boss's boss is even worse. But anyway, her boss, my boss's boss, had yelled at her about the situation that wasn't even her fault. And she called me crying. She was just really distraught. And so it gave me an opportunity to witness to her and to just, you know, spend some time and try to encourage her. You know, so I was thankful because of the 5 people on our team. In fact, one of them is out in California where she's at. And two of them are in California where she's at. 2 of them are here in Des Moines, one's in Minneapolis. You know, of the other 4 people she could have called, she called me. And so I had the opportunity to talk to her and to tell her I'd be praying for her on these things. Because I don't know where she stands. She's Chinese. I don't think goes to church. They have a whole different way of believing. But I was thankful because, you know, I'm also learning. You know, I grew up thinking that God tested you all the time and God did all these things to you. But the Holy Spirit's been showing me. So, you know, I've shared with you, Tim, you know, and people on Facebook. You know, I've been praying 1 to 2 hours a day now. You know, I didn't think I had the time to do it. And I've noticed that God's really been changing me and he's been revealing things to me. And I understand now, you know, what the trials really are. The trials are God is the righteous judge, Jesus is our defendant, and then the devil's the one who accuses. You know, just like what Pastor's been saying. So I'm learning more and more now that it's not God that's doing these things to me, but the enemy who's trying to do these things and trying to bring these accusations. And Jesus is standing in my place defending me. And God, who's the righteous judge, will ultimately judge all of this. But I'm learning in all of this prayer time and all these things who God really is. And so I'm having people at work come to me. I have another coworker that lives in Pleasant Hill that comes to me when she's having issues, you know, and just needs me to listen. And so I'm just so thankful because God is changing me so that I can listen, so that I can give these people hope and encouragement. So I just wanted to, you know, one, I need prayer for a new job at some point. Because my boss's boss is blaming me and my boss for something that I warned him months and months ago would happen. But he didn't listen. Now he doesn't want it on him, so he's blaming us. So, you know, that's where we're at. But anyway, God is good, like you're saying.
Well, praise the Lord, we'll be praying for you. Because that's really what it's about.
Yes.
Right.
charge over thee,
yes,
to keep thee in all thy ways. And they shall lift thee up with their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. What does that mean? Now, I'm not sure that I understand all of that, but back in June the 10th when I died, nurses come out, picked me up, and just the other day they was telling me, you know, they had me up here. Now, two nurses, 90 pounds apiece, but they, because it's between two cars and parked, you know, in a parking lot, and why is he so light? He shall give his angels charge,
Jesus,
over thee,
yes,
to keep in all that. They shall lift thee up with their hands. I've been touched by an angel.
Yes.
But I've been touched by an angel.
Yeah.
I mean, that's care that God gives to you. I didn't ask for it, but it was there.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, I was listening to Joe Osteen, just a short story, and he was saying that he was going to Africa years ago and was in the airport and wanted to bring his camera along. And to check in, they said that he had to check it in and he wanted to take it on board because it was so expensive. And she said, you can't do that. And she repeatedly told him, and he said, well, you know, it's really important that I have it with me. And so this guy came, the pilot came by and said, what's the problem here? And he said, well, she said, well, he wants to take on, carry on the camera. And he said, well, where are you going? The pilot says, where are you going? He says, Africa. He said, well, I'm the pilot. He says, why don't you just put it right behind my seat in the cockpit? And he just looked at the check-in girl and went, and I heard him say, Nana and boo boo. You know, I say this because yesterday I had a recent, well, I feel the Holy Spirit speaking to me more and more.
Yes.
But I went to Walmart yesterday morning at about 7 o'clock.
It's time to go.
And have my oil changed. I pulled up to the door, the guy came on our face. He said, well, we're supposed to be open, but I'm the only one here, so I can't really work on your vehicle. So I said, okay, and I went in, did some shopping, I came back, and there was like, I came back about 8 o'clock, and there were three cars ahead of me. And he said, okay, I'm glad you came back, but you'll be 25 minutes, and then your car will be after that. And I said, okay. And I thought about it a minute, and I said, I went out and I asked him, I said, you know, I was here at 7 o'clock, as the kids kind of bumped me up a little bit, and, you know, because I came back, and so they just said, well, no, he didn't give me an answer, so I went inside the waiting room, and I'm sitting there, and God says, I have the answer.
Yes.
You know? Cast all your cares on me, 1 Peter 5:6. For I care for you.
Yes.
I went out to shop, and I was watching them do this car in front of me, and they said, "Well, we can't drain your oil because your oil pan plug is stripped out," to the other customer. And I just sat there, looked up, and my car was next, and I said, "Thank you, Jesus."
Yeah.
There you go.
So you know. It's not, man. Just casting my cares on the Holy Spirit and allowing the Holy Spirit to lead me every minute, every hour, you know, and just a blessing.
Amen.
Amen. That's good.
Yes.
Just I'll lift up Suzanne, Michael's second mother, as that was phrased, passed away last Friday. Don't know exactly when the funeral is in Cedar Rapids. Suzanne's with them right now. I pray the family gets touched by the Lord in this situation, let the enemy cause for destruction, the Lord turn around for his glory. Michael needs a say that. I'm not judging him. I just understand that realm of what's going on. Be with Erica and Eric. Being Erica is in the midst of moving situation. There's some financial things that are going on there also. For Jody, who's not here today. Roberto, as he's traveling. Just watch over them. I know there's a lot of stuff going on. Just pray for God's wisdom to be understood by the worship team and stuff.
And we'll do that.
As he is talking, I heard somebody say this morning, which I really like. I never thought about it, but the Lord gets right in the middle of everything. He gets right in our cereal bowl, you know.
Yeah.
He doesn't just try to solve things from a way off, but he gets right where we are,
that's
whatever
right.
issue we have. But that just reminded me of that. That's what my prayer request is. I'm working with this cancer society now, and it breaks my heart. I went into a home the other day, and it's all the lady could do to get out of bed to even let me in. And she laid down the whole entire time we were there. I mean, I couldn't even, she couldn't even, she didn't even have a voice that she could even talk to us. That's how weak she is with this cancer and her lungs. I clean two houses tomorrow with people with cancer. This breaks my heart. So as I was about ready to leave, I just says, you know, I just want to ask you if you're a believer. And she says, yes. I says, is it okay if I just lay hands on you and pray with you then? You know, every day we just have so much to be grateful for. You look at pictures on the wall and there's kids there. She's like, don't touch the kids' rooms. They haven't done anything. Every day that we have, we just need to value and appreciate. And, you know, as I walked out, I thought, man, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can claim for this organization because it breaks my heart so bad. And I just told her that we would remember her in prayer, that the Lord would just raise her back up. His will be done. Her name is Jessie. Tomorrow I clean for two others who are in the same situation, but not down as she is. So, no, I just feel like God, you put me here for a reason. It's not just to clean their house. So if it's just to give them a word of encouragement or whatever, you know.
We'll
just pray that the Lord would use me to be wise.
God's been dealing with me about a lot of things, but this morning, I can't get it out of my head. I want to thank him that he's a right-now God.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, in my head, I eventually I'll be able to pay off all my, I mean, I told myself this in my head. Eventually, when I get all my bills paid off and all my ducks in a row, then I'll be able to give more offerings and I'll be able to do more. You know what? That woman that had the pennies gave all that she had.
Right. Yep.
You know, I pay my tithes, and I'm not doing that for a pat on the back. I do that because God is my source.
That's right.
And,
yes.
And as I was getting
yes.
ready this morning, God said to me, how much do you spend on groceries?
Mm.
And I thought it out of my head. I thought, you know, you never buy this, you buy this. You got to have food for this physical body. But you know what? We're being fed here spiritually. How much more, you know? Maybe that's what fasting is about. Maybe we should be giving more to the man who's feeding us spiritually than our groceries. I don't know what the God's dealing with me about a lot of things.
Yes.
But you know, he's a right now God. Let's look right now. We are to take what we have and bless others in
that's
everything
right.
that we have.
Yes.
And if you stay focused on right now and what God's doing, favor, everything, it takes us out of the picture and just makes him more and more the picture, which is what he's supposed to be. I am so grateful that he continues to talk to us and that he is a right now God.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Praise God because for Tammy's words of wisdom, because I needed to hear that.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if anybody else did, but thank you, Jesus, and thank you, Tammy.
Yes.
That's awesome. Yeah. Yes.
Think on cancer. You know people that have cancer. Of course, we're admonished to pray and the healing and we have, and sometimes that doesn't work. You know, something is hindering it. But physically, a very simple solution is 2 teaspoons of baking soda a day has made a difference in cancer patients in 30 days or 2 months, you know. And it's a very simple thing that you can start right now. So anybody, you know, realize the cancer patient, it doesn't hurt anything, you try.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true.
That too.
So true. All right, yes.
Mike said Jody, but remember Jody?
Yes.
Hopefully the growth has gone down and that's taken care of.
Yes.
And Allison and her kids, they're fighting something again. I mean, this has gone on for the last month. They get one thing, then it goes on to another thing. They just need prayer for you. Amen.
Yes.
My brother and Uncle Rick are going to battle. My brother has not severe, but a little bit of blood going back from the outside of the brain, down the back.
Oh.
He fell in his head and hit a truck on a diesel. And then my Uncle Rick is battling cancer.
Oh.
Well, not kind of cancer, but he had shirt on his back.
Okay.
Okay,
yes.
You know, I was talking to my brothers the other day. We were talking about the fact that when Jesus went back to Nazareth, that one of my brothers said, no, their unbelief, he could do no miracles. And I used to believe that. I think we talked about it once before, but it was not their unbelief. I mean, God can do anything. But their unbelief, and this is what we see in the world today, they make no demands on God.
No.
If I don't believe in healing, I'm certainly not going to ask for it. But it goes back to that, and I want everybody to hear this. We have not because we ask not.
There you go.
Now, I mean, let that sink in. We have not because we ask not. And I think so many times, how many times we've missed out on things because we just didn't ask. Or we thought that somehow we didn't deserve it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't. I want to tell you, well, I don't know about the rest of you, but I know this boy. I don't deserve anything. I will never be able to stand and say, well, I've done this for God, I've done that for God, and I've walked away from all those wicked people out there. No, I've been right in there with them. I've been probably as wicked as any of them. But I'll tell you what, God has had mercy on me.
Yes.
He's kept.
Yes.
He's blessed me.
Amen.
You know, I told my brother. huge to me. Maybe I haven't killed anybody. I haven't done a lot of things, but I've done things that have disappointed me.
Yeah.
I wanted to be able to stand at the end and look him right in the eye and say, I have never done anything but worshiped you every day, every minute, every hour. I will never be able to say that. But I understand more and more the scriptures come alive when Paul talked about with the spirit, with my mind, I worship God.
Yes.
With this flesh, it is continually letting me down.
Yeah.
But I got up this morning, and the first thing that popped into my mind was this. The race is not to the swiftest,
that's right,
but to him that endured to the end.
Yes.
And we are living in a time like Elijah, when the prophets of Baal, and the people just were like, we haven't seen God move in years and years. We've heard about it. We've read about it.
Mm-hmm.
We believe it, I guess, but we really haven't seen it. So maybe these other gods that come in, maybe we'll give that a shot, you know. And Elijah said, Lord, we got to do something. We've got to show. I believe God is waiting for us to say, Lord, enough.
Yes.
We're asking you to show the people. And what did the people say? The people said, hey, that's good. We just want to know. And I think of all the people we all know out there that they're not really bad. They just, you witness to them and you feel like they're kind of absorbing it. But then, you know, they just don't know. Well, yeah, I've heard about it. But I've never seen anything. I've never seen the dead come to life. Now, when I'm talking about dead, hey, I'm talking about dead. Somebody embalmed, somebody that's been dead 3 or 4 days. I want to see them raise up.
Come on.
I believe we're going to see it.
Yes.
Yeah.
But we got to think bigger.
Yes.
We can't just come here on Sunday and, you know, and we do it. But God has challenged us to reach way bigger and expect those things that we read about.
Exactly.
My God, look at the things that have been done. The whole 11th chapter of Hebrews.
Amen.
The faith chapter. You know, Paul said, I run out of time trying to tell you the things that have been done. And then he says, seeing therefore, we are camped about by so great a cloud of witness. What is he talking about? All of those that did that. They're waiting for us.
Yeah.
Oh, I want to tell you what. We've got to get out there and think way bigger than we're willing. We're just willing to accept the crumbs that fall off the table.
Amen.
And God's saying, come on, somebody get up there and really, like that little woman that crawled through that crowd and touched the hem of his garment. And he said, well, who touched me? And they looked at him and said, are you kidding? You've been knocked around, pushed on, shoved on. He said, oh, no.
Uh-huh.
Oh, no. Something happened that virtue went out of me.
Yes.
Somebody had a need, and without just my presence fulfilled that need and healed her.
Okay.
That's what we got to get up.
Amen.
Yes.
That's good.
Amen.
Yeah. 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 Just for you, God. Just for you, God.
To me, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, and that's part
I give my whole heart, whole life. How, you know, like you always look, we always look at David and Goliath. We always look at that picture. But, you know, and if you look at it from the natural, there's no way David should have defeated Goliath. Mm-hmm. I mean, Goliath was a soldier since he was younger, and he was this huge force up there.
Yeah.
You know, and the rest of the soldiers were scared of him. The one that should have went toe-to-toe with Saul, because he was taller, head and shoulder, but even Goliath was too big. Saul didn't want to take him on. I'll take him on. Because, see, he's coming in his power, and I'm coming in the name of the Lord. That's
yeah.
where I'm going. And it talks about David ran toward him.
That's right.
He ran toward him, and he's doing the slaying, and he hits him. You know, he falls down dead. He wanted to make sure he was dead, and everybody saw he was dead. He took his own sword, Goliath's sword, and cut his head off. Yeah, I tell you what, he is dead.
Yeah.
And as we got to get to that point, we're going to run toward that and not away from it. And a lot of times God is like, do you have faith? Do you trust me? That's what God is looking at for those people that will believe God.
Yes.
Not just like I said, not just out here in the future, but right now, because the Bible says he's a present help. Right now, he's a present God. Right now. Because like I say, some prayers, some prayers to look at, yeah, they can be answered in the future, but I'm telling you, there's some that got to be answered right now. They can't be answered tomorrow. They have to be answered right at this point. I've driven a truck long enough to know that when that trailer starts sliding around on you, that I need that prayer answered right now. Because I'm telling you, you're doing some serious praying when you're dancing around with an 80,000-pound partner, let me tell you. You're doing some serious. Let's go ahead and stand up for prayer, please. Hallelujah. Father God, we have a lot of needs for you before you today. The young lady that's going to have a baby, Lord, that you would be with that situation. Lord, that you have plans for that baby in there. You have plans for all of us, Lord. And Lord, we thank you this morning for the testimonies. Oh Lord, the situation with Suzanne and all those situations, the lady with cancer and Sheila mentioned, and the job situation. There is nothing too hard for you. Hallelujah. There's nothing. We look at that. All things. The Bible said all things are possible. It doesn't say a few things. It doesn't say something. Some things might. It said all things are possible. God. And that's where we got to look at. The all things, those situations that we have to believe in God to turn around. Lord, we're going to ask you to turn around today that you can start working on them. Oh, Lord, let us be a light. Lord, you can give Peter just the right job that he can be used in that job. A light. He can be a light because that's what you call us. Those situations in our lives, Lord, that look hopeless, you're the God of hope. We hope thou in God. That's what we're going to do. Lord, you answer us before we even get the request out. You're always working, Lord. Hallelujah. And all those things going to work together for the good of those that love God. Hallelujah. The heaven that raised up before God and the angels lifted him up. We know that's God. Some situations we just got to look up, and that's all we can say is God. All we can say is thank God. Which way should I go? But Jesus, you settled that. Because you said you are the way. Hallelujah. You are the truth and the life. That's the way to go. God's way is the way to go. That's the only way. Hallelujah. It always starts the same way. The Bible says, in the beginning, God. Hallelujah. And Revelation says, I'm the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. We just stay between them bookends and we'll be all right. The one thing about it, that Adam and Eve, that the Lord came walking in the cool of the day. He had that communication with him. Hallelujah. That's what we need to do, continue to communicate with God. And let him know what's going on in the hearts and lives. Let him know that, you know what, we're not going to just be those Christians who just accept the way things are. We're going to look up and say, God, why not? Why can't this happen? Why can't this life change? Hallelujah. We know that you're in the saving business. We know that you're in the delivery business. We know that you're in the healing business.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
We know that you can provide. Hallelujah. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for what you will do for us. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that we had. We thank you today that we was able to get up this morning. lifted up before all men unto you. Let's lift you up today. I must praise your name. The Bible said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. It doesn't make any difference. It's at all times. That's good times, bad times, any time. I'm going to praise the Lord. It doesn't matter what I'm going through. I know the one that made it through. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Tim. Thank you, Brother Tim. He wasn't aware if he was going to be opening till 5 till 10, and I love how the Lord just has him ready. I love it.
Oh, yes. Thank you, man.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As soon as we get James back, we'll go. Hallelujah. The whole song list changed. I emailed them out Thursday night, and I normally don't do them until Sunday or Saturday. I came in here, usually takes about an hour or so to get prepped up, but next thing I know, it was an hour and a half later, and God's moving in this place because of your hunger for his love, for his presence. And as I was preparing, I was going through songs, and her kids playing on the stoop out there, and I know sometimes it could be a distraction, but guess what? Some of the children, they would have come unto me.
Yes.
I didn't see it as a distraction. Well, about a half an hour, 45 minutes later, as I was chasing after the Lord, Lord, what do you want to reveal? What is on your heart? I looked back and I saw light in the hallway. Then I heard little voices. Then I see these three walking in who weren't here yesterday. They're downstairs right now in the Sunday school room. So the Lord is drawing, and I went outside. When I saw the door open, and I said, how you girls doing? And there was like 7 or 8 girls out there just playing and stuff like that. And, well, we just wanted to come in and see what it was like in there. I said, well, unfortunately, I'm by myself. And if there was someone else here, I could show you around and stuff. But the way things are in our society today, I couldn't do it. But I told them and invited them there here this morning. But there's a drawing going on for the next generation. And I'd be careful. I talked to him for a little bit outside where everything was full plain view because I know the ways of the accuser. I know the ways of the accuser. But I pray the Lord would draw them back. There would be opportunity that they would be ministered to with Jamie and her team downstairs, that these little ones in this neighborhood, that they would be touched and ministered to. And that their families would also be ministered to, because I've seen so many churches start through the children, through Sidewalk Sunday School, through other ministries that the Lord chooses. So I pray that the Lord would be revealed in them, that the hunger that they are showing in their heart would be filled with the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 I want to see them dance in this place, Lord. I want to see them dance, Lord. I want to see them shout out, Lord, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are worthy of all praise. Let your glory be known. Come on, Tammy.
We shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation's in this place. You're the name by which we're saved. Jesus. Jesus. Let your name be lifted high. As our thankful hearts now cry, Jesus, Jesus, lift up your heads, you ancient gates, be lifted high, you ancient doors, the King is coming in, the King is coming in, we lift up a shout to shake the skies, lift up a cry, be glorified, the King is coming. for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation's in this place, hear the name by which we're saved. Jesus. Jesus, let your name be lifted high as our thankful hearts now cry. Jesus, Jesus, lift up your head, you ancient gates, be lifted high, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. Glorified, the King is coming in.
Yes, he's coming in.
The King is coming in.
Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. You're worthy of our prayer. Hallelujah, Lord. Here we go. Here we go.
We're the people of God with a song to sing, and we're bringing our lives as an offering. We will dance for your glory, Lord. As your cross is the hope and is hold on high, as we fill the world of your love and light, we will dance for your glory, Lord. Lift up your head, you ancient gates, be lifted high, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up a shout to shake the skies. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Glory, we will dance for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
We will lift up a shout.
We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
Let out a shout, church.
A song of celebration, lift up a shout of
Hallelujah!
Praise, for the bridegroom will come, the glorious one, and all will look on his face, will go. Your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, when we will appear, and all will stand by his side. A strong, pure, spotless bride. Golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. from every tongue and tribe and nation will draw in the song of the Lamb.
Sing a song.
Sing a song of celebration. Lift up a shout of praise,
come on,
for the bridegroom will come. Glorious One, and gold will look on His face, will go to a much better place. Dance with all your might, lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, when He will appear, and all will stand by His side, a strong, pure, spotless bride. On the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man, from every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb.
We will dance, we will dance.
We will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. Every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. The groom is preparing a place for His bride. Jesus is coming again. Therefore eternity close by His side. Jesus is coming again. His Father's words, His Father will say, Jesus is coming again. Go get your bride, for the wedding's today. Jesus is coming again. And we will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. We will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. We'll join in the song of the Lamb.
Sing it out.
We'll join in the song of the
show me your face, Lord. Show me your face. Then gird up my legs that I might stand in this holy place. Show face, Lord. I could just see your face. Show yourself to your people, Lord, to say, Moses stood. Because Moses stood on the mountain, waiting for you to pass by. You put your hand over his face, so in your presence he wouldn't die. All Israel saw the glory and the shine. David knew there was something more than the ark of your presence. In a manger a baby was born, among the kings and the presence. And all of Israel
God. Let's praise him right now. Thank you, Lord. Father, we bless you. We praise you. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Well, Moses wanted to see the face of God, and God said, you can't, no man can see my face and live. So he put Jesus between Moses and Almighty God, the rock. Hit him in the cleft of the rock. And he's been doing the same thing from time immemorial. Jesus stands between us and the wrath of God, the perfection of God, the holiness of God, the righteousness of God, and declares us accepted in the beloved, able to approach Almighty God, able to come boldly to the throne of grace and receive all of His goodness, all of His mercy, all of His provision. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Thank you, worship team. Hallelujah. I know we have Jamie's gone. Do we have someone here for Sunday school? Oh, is she here? Okay, good, good. Okay, kids, you may go downstairs, for the Sunday school kids can go downstairs if they like. You're going home? Oh, okay. Well, maybe this would be a good place for her to get good, huh? Bye, kids. Hope you'll come back. I can think of better ways to punish your kids and send them home from Sunday school, but that's just me. Praise the Lord. Amen. At least they got to be here for a little while, and hopefully they'll be back. Praise God. Never want to get between a mother and her cubs. Praise God. That's not a good thing. Well, I'm going to be brief this morning, but I want us to start in Luke chapter 24. Verses 44 and 45. Luke 24, verses 44 and 45. Praise God. Back up here. Praise God. And he said unto them, "These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me." Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scriptures. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. We are going to have communion when we wrap up here, and that's why I'm saying it's not going to be a long message here, but hopefully one that will speak to us. "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." And lastly, Romans chapter 8 and verse 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And if we don't, I know sometimes we read the Bible and it's a struggle sometimes, and I know for years it was for me. Today, there are times when I struggle with what God is really trying to say in the Scripture. That's one of the reasons why we come together in the beginning of a service. A lot of times things are opened up to us that, you know, maybe we've had one particular way of thinking about it or seeing, and then all of a sudden we get some revelation because God is speaking through somebody else. But if we don't see Scripture in terms of revealing Jesus, and this is what he's talking about there in Luke chapter 24, in fact, in all of these Scriptures, if we don't see the Bible or the Scriptures in terms of revealing Jesus and us in him, then we've missed the point of the Scriptures. And the result is the Bible is reduced to a list of do's and don'ts, heroes and villains, good guys and bad guys, winners and losers. And Jesus didn't come to be our homeboy or our buddy or our life coach. He came as God and man. And let's look at this again in Luke chapter 24, verse 27. I'm going to be easy on you this morning, Sheila. I don't have a whole lot of scriptures, at least not like usual. I'm going to use the scriptures. I'm just not going to refer directly to a scripture. So. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things that concerned him. All of the scripture, he expounded to these disciples the scriptures and the things that went on in those scriptures concerning Jesus. So we got Adam in the garden, but Jesus goes beyond Adam, who rebelled and broke relationship in the garden. Jesus remained obedient and didn't fail the test that he had in the Garden of Gethsemane. He didn't hide from God, but he prayed to God. He drew near to God and submitted himself, bringing restoration between God and us. Jesus transcends Abel, who was killed by his brother, but who was also a sinner. Jesus remained the sinless sacrifice. Jesus is greater than Noah, who built the ark to save people from the flood. Jesus became the ark and absorbed the wrath of God so that everyone who enters into him will be saved. And Jesus is greater than Abraham, who by faith offered his son Isaac as a sacrifice. Jesus became the perfect sacrifice. Jesus is greater than Isaac, who carried wood to the place of the sacrifice, because Jesus carried the wooden cross to Calvary. Praise the Lord. Jesus is greater than Joseph, who suffered at the hands of his own brothers, but was put at the right hand of the king of Egypt, and then forgave and provided for those who betrayed him. Jesus sits at the right hand of God, where Jesus extends grace and is our provision, even though we betrayed him. Jesus is greater than Moses, who was a mediator between God and man while he was here on earth and gave us the law as it was given to him. But Jesus fulfilled the law, and he lives as our only mediator between God and man, who gave us the law of the new covenant, the law of love, not written on stones, but written in his own blood. Praise the Lord. Jesus is greater than Job. Amen. Job served God well. He endured suffering. But Jesus suffered as a sinless man. And like Job's friends failed him, Jesus' disciples failed Jesus. Praise the Lord. And Jesus is greater than Esther. Unlike Esther, who risked her life by coming before the king, Jesus gave his life freely in the palace of Pilate. Praise the Lord. Jesus is greater than Boaz. When Boaz redeemed Ruth and brought her, a heathen, into the family of God, Jesus redeemed his bride, the church, from all the nations of the earth. Praise God. David killed Goliath. Jesus defeated Satan, sin, hell, and death, and satisfied the wrath of God. Instead of committing adultery like David, Jesus saved the prostitute and restored her dignity. Praise God. Jesus is greater than Elijah, who offered sacrifices at Mount Carmel. Jesus became the sacrifice, not to prove the God of Israel the one true God, but to offer himself the one true God in the flesh. Praise God. Jesus is greater than Noah, who spent 3 days in the belly of a fish. Hallelujah. Resulted in the saving of Nineveh. Jesus spent 3 days in the grave, beginning and bringing salvation to everyone who would believe on him. Praise God. And instead of pouting over those who repented like Jonah, all of heaven, including Jesus, rejoices at the repentance and the salvation of one sinner. Hallelujah. Jesus is our God. Jesus is the mighty God. Nehemiah rebuilt Jerusalem Jesus brings us the new Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Hosea married a prostitute and continued to love her even when she was unfaithful to him. Jesus does even more for his unfaithful bride, the church. Praise God. Jesus is the great high priest who doesn't sacrifice animals but gave his own life a sacrifice for the sin of the world. Amen. Jesus, the true King of Kings, who sets us free and pays our debts. Praise the Lord. And provide provision for all of his subjects. Praise God. Jesus, the great judge who restores his people and declares us innocent before the throne of God. Hallelujah. Jesus, the true temple of God. Hallelujah. The final lamb taking away the sin of the world. The Bible is his story and the covenant between God and us as believers. Hallelujah. That's the Bible. That's the scripture. That's the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's what the Word of God is for, to remind us of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done and what he continues to do in the lives of those who will believe on him. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. John chapter 4, verse 7 through 10. Thank you, Jesus. There is no other name given among men. There is no name greater, and every knee shall bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Praise the God. 24 and 26, verse 24 and 26. Hallelujah. I'm feeling better already. Praise God. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah come, which is called Christ. When he is come, he'll tell us all things. And Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Praise God. But here he is again, praise God, breaking the rules, pushing back the boundaries in order to love somebody. He's telling us today, come face to face. Thank you for that last song, Mike. I didn't know what it was going to be, but I just knew we needed one more. Hallelujah. He says this to all of us. He extends that to everybody. Come to me. Not just come to me secondarily, not as a voyeuristic way, but come to me face to face. Come and see that God is good. See and taste and touch the goodness of God. Drink the water. Receive the grace, praise God. Believe that he loves you and believe it right now. Hallelujah. Right now, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're struggling with, no matter what you think about yourself, no matter what somebody else has said about you, believe that God loves you and is for you and wants to bless you right now, today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Take a really messy life. Take my life and multiply it by millions. And you've got the church of Jesus Christ. Oh, I think we ought to just say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. The church is not perfect except in the eyes of God. The church is filled with imperfect people that are flawed, corrupt, but loved by God and declared by God to be the righteousness of God. This is the great gift. This is the story of Christ himself. For he came to save those that were lost, that had no means by which they might save themselves. Just like Don was talking about, like it's been said by all of us. None of us deserve it. That's the beauty of the good news. Nobody deserves it. It's the grace of God. It's the goodness of God. It's the love of God in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, I love that name. Praise God. Praise God. Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. Beginning to feel like I'm back in a Pentecostal church. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we sit down, we open the Bible, and we're intimidated. When it's a love story from God, a love letter to you from God, here's where you start. You invite the author to sit down with you, to join you. There's more love to be received, because deep calleth unto deep. There's more truth to be believed. There's more grace than we've imagined. Romans chapter 8, and this will be the lengthiest part of the scripture, Romans 8, 28 through 39, and then we'll move into the communion mode here, although this is all leading up to communion. Praise the Lord. Romans 8, 28 through 39. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God. That might come as shock to some of us, because a lot of junk happens. But I'm telling you, if the word is true at all, then all of it's true. Yes. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Yes. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? Right. It's God justifieth. Yes. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loves us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Now, communion, all of this leads to this. It's just true of where the scripture says, Jesus speaking himself said, you search the scriptures, you're looking for me, and here I am, and you don't recognize me. You won't accept me. Well, there's kind of a correlation there between that and communion, where he talks about not discerning the body. But I don't want to get into all that this morning for the sake of time. I just want to say that communion is God's way of bringing healing and wholeness to us. Yes. And we're going to begin doing it in this church once a month. We used to do it on a regular basis. And, you know, I just think that it can become just a ritual if you're not careful. You can take communion at home. I think everybody realizes that and knows that you don't need a preacher, you know, somebody with a license or somebody that stands in the pulpit. You have that right as a child of God to take communion. As often as you do it in remembrance of the Lord. You can do it in your own home. You can do it every day. And I would advise that you do, especially when you're going through issues, especially if you've got health problems and so on and so forth. But we're going to do it at least once a month in the church, as a way of remembering what Christ has done for us. Amen? So it's God's way of bringing healing and wholeness to us in ways that we might not otherwise experience. Praise the Lord. All right, so let's look at this, Sheila. Mark chapter 7, verses 26 and 28. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. This is not a Jew. This isn't the people that Jesus came to. This is a Gentile outside of the body of Christ. But Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled, for it's not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. And she answered and said to him, yes, Lord, but yet the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. He's talking about bread as healing. He calls healing the children's bread. We are children of God. We have a right to the bread. We have a right to healing.
Yes.
It's ours by virtue of the fact that we are the children of God.
Yes.
And the woman wisely said that even if you're not a child of God, if you'll believe, if you'll eat the crumbs, you can even be healed by the crumbs that are falling from those who do believe.
Come on.
How many of you know people that have been healed that didn't even necessarily believe in healing? Amen. Why? Because they got some crumbs from somebody who did believe, somebody who did have the bread and was willing to share that, amen, with an unbeliever or with someone who was outside of what we would think of as the body.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So bread is for healing. Jesus' body, he said, this bread, this is my body, this bread was broken so that yours can be whole.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Praise God. The Old Testament, and I just touched on some things here this morning. There are, I mean, it's just, that's all there is in the Old Testament, are types and shadows of Jesus. I just went through some that I know would be familiar with everybody. But the Old Testament is a shadow and a type. The New Testament is the real substance. It's the reality. Jesus is the true, perfect Lamb. He is the Passover. He is the temple. He is, you know, the high priest. He is everything that we have types and shadows of symbolically in the Old Testament. He is the fulfillment. He is the reality. That's why I don't go back. I had a prayer shawl. I gave it to an older woman who it meant something to. Because it just was a shawl. And I don't look good in shawls. Y'all, praise the Lord. I'm not against them. I'm just saying, it's just a type. Jesus, I wrap myself in Jesus. He has wrapped us in Him. He is our garment of praise. He is everything, amen, that we need. If it helps somebody, fine. I'm not condemning that. I'm just saying, too many times we go backwards and trying to find something that God has already fulfilled. We're trying to get the fulfillment out of some type. And that's what troubles me sometimes when we always talking about revival. Mike said it right. I'm grateful for every revival that ever came, but I don't want to go back to Azusa. That's 100 years ago. We've got far more revelation than they did. That was the thing that God did then. It was the now thing for that time to bring us into a place where people could believe in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, where they could see that God was still wanting to give people His Spirit in a demonstrative way. So that healing could come, so that deliverance could come, so that all these things. I'm so grateful for Pentecost. I'm grateful for it. And it goes on to this day. It's not over, but it's not the same as it was in 1900.
Right. Right.
God is the same, but it takes us time to catch up to God.
Right.
We're finding out things about God that have always been.
Right.
I found out things about God in the last year that I didn't know about God before. But God was always that thing. He was always able to be there and to do that, even though I didn't know it or I wasn't aware of it.
Come on, come on.
So He's always the God of the now. He's always the God who's trying to open us up to the new, the now. He wants to do a new thing. In fact, Jesus said, I make all things new.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, He's the perfect Lamb. His blood covers sins. He said, in Exodus, He said, when I see the blood, I'm going to pass over.
Yeah.
I'm not going to judge that place where the blood is.
Right.
If you were an Egyptian and you put blood on the lintels and the doorposts, He passed over. You didn't have to be a Jew to be spared. You just had to apply the blood. And it's true today. You don't have to be a Baptist. You don't have to be a Pentecostal. You don't have to be. You just got to apply the blood, praise God. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to do it all right. You just got to know enough that it's the blood that's going to take care of the situation. It's the blood that's going to cause the wrath of God to pass over you, amen, and fall on someone who won't accept the blood of Jesus. This cup is my blood, He said, shed for your sins, for the remission amen, of your sins. That means they're gone. They're remitted. They don't exist. Exodus chapter 12 and verse 8, Sheila. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Blood, I said, is for forgiveness. But the body of Jesus, the bread, is for divine strength. They were about to go on a journey that was going to last 40 years. And the scripture says when they came out of there, these were slaves. These were people who were beaten, who were abused, who were taken advantage, who weren't treated well, who didn't get the best of everything. But they went out of there none halt, none lame. They all marched out of there from the oldest to the youngest without any limps, without any missing limbs, without any blindness. They all came out in divine strength because they ate that lamb. Praise the Lord. The bread was for strength. All right? Praise the Lord. Mike, if you and John, would you two mind passing out the elements here for the communion? So I hope you're hearing what I'm saying. Don't look at this as a cracker or a wafer or, and I'm not sure what Sally used, if it's matzah bread. I guess it is. It's matzah bread. All the better. Praise the Lord. But don't look at this as juice or wine or a cracker or matzah bread. This is the body of Jesus. And this is the blood. And don't let the enemy freak you into not taking communion because you'll take it unworthily. That's a misnomer. We all are unworthy. We're just hoping and praying and believing in the promises of Jesus. What I want you to do is look at Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, the healer, the one who suffered those stripes for your body to be healed, the one who became poor so that you might become rich, the one who was cut off from God so that you could have a continuous relationship with God. The one who was betrayed so that all of your relationships can be restored. Whatever your need is, Jesus is it. That was my reason for reading these little brief things throughout the Bible. Whatever it is you have need of, Jesus is that.
Yes.
So if I haven't, you know, spoken it in verbiage, believe it in your heart anyway. Whatever your need is, if I haven't addressed it, it's still God's provision.
Yes.
God will still provide for whatever that need is. You may have something that seems, you know, totally, you know, strange and bizarre to anything we've been talking about. Believe me, if it's a need, God wants to meet that need. He is your provider. He is your Jehovah Jireh. Praise the Lord. So whatever it is, if it's a job, believe Jesus is that job. He's going to open the door for that job. If it's a relationship that needs to be restored, believe He's going to do that. He is the one. He is the only one. If you're struggling with some other issue, addictions, problems, whatever, and believe me, we all got them. I don't say this in any way to judge or to criticize or to critique. For the most part, I don't know anything anyway except my own problems, and that's more than enough. And I don't say that just to be, you know, condescending or like, oh, isn't he nice to say that he's got problems. No, I'm not. I'm saying it because I got them, okay? I'm just being honest. I'm not trying to be humble or to get you to pat me on the back and say, well, that was really good that you did. That makes people easier for them to do it. No, I'm saying it because it's the truth. And it's the truth of all of us. Though they may vary, to God, they're all the same. They're coming short. But Jesus has bridged that gap. The thing that we couldn't do, the thing that we can't do today, He's already provided the means to be accepted in the beloved. God loves you. God accepts you. He wants more for you, but He loves you in spite of the fact that you don't operate there. He's not measuring you based on how much better you're doing today than you were yesterday. He's measured you once and for all in the perfection of Jesus Christ and has found you perfect in Him. So whatever your need is today, let's just take the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 through 28. As they were eating, Jesus took bread and He blessed it and He broke it and He gave it to the disciples and He said, "Take, eat. This is My body." We're not Catholic. We don't believe in transubstantiation. We don't believe it's a literal body. If we did, we wouldn't need faith. This is faith in the words of Jesus. We just took His body. How can you take a perfect, holy... You know, Jesus, He didn't always walk on water. He didn't always calm storms. But He went about healing everybody. Healing is what He always did. Healing for your body, healing for your mind, healing for your situation, your circumstance, whatever it might be, healing for your job situation. That's what you've just received. Just believe it. Just look to Him, not to you, not to your situation. Look to Him. And He took the cup and He gave thanks. Thank you, Jesus. And He gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it. For this is My blood of the New Testament, the New Covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." This is Jesus, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end and everything in between. And by faith, we have just received His forgiveness, His grace, His healing, and His deliverance. Now go and walk in that freedom, in that truth, and it will set you free. In Jesus' name, give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise the Lord. God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here today. Remember, it's all about Him. That's not a cliche. It's the fact. It's all good in Him. Don't feel bad. Don't be depressed. Don't feel guilty. Just be grateful and thankful that God sees you perfect in Christ. And nobody, not even you, can change that. God bless you. You are dismissed in the great and mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Have a great week. Go in the power of His might.
Oh, come.